Well, thank you, Ian. Thank you very much for that introduction. And thanks to all of you for coming and for having me come here. I've really enjoyed my visit so far. I've gotten to talk with a lot of you, and it's been very good interactions. My talk, and let me just apologize in advance, the technology here might be, I'm probably going to have a few dysfunctions, so as the slides advance or detract when they're not supposed to, bear with me. Symbiosis has really been pivotal to the development of life on Earth. Essentially, all eukaryotic organisms bear signatures of ancient symbioses in their cells in the forms of mitochondria and chloroplasts. And in the present day, ongoing symbioses between independent or semi-independent organisms continue to play a role in the evolutionary trajectory and ecological interactions that species experience. For insects, for those of us that are entomologists particularly, when you think about symbioses between an insect and a microbe, what often comes to mind are nutritional symbioses. So a partnership in which an insect or some other arthropod and a microbe are working together, in which the microbe compensates for some sort of nutritional deficiency in the insect host diet. So for example, termites and their protist symbionts, in which the protist assists in cellulose digestion, or we have the pea aphid here, and this sort of obscure picture, the fluorescing green organ is the bacteriome, which houses Buchnera, which is an obligate symbiont for the pea aphid, which assists with amino acids, which are deficient in the phloem diet of the aphid. Likewise, this blood feeders, such as this tsetse fly here, also have a bacteriome which helps with provision of things that are lacking from a blood diet, such as B vitamins. All of these interactions that I'm describing here are obligate in both directions. That is, the microbe is dependent on the insect host for an environment, and the host, in return, is essentially dependent on the organism. They cannot really survive and reproduce to any great degree if those symbionts are removed. My interest actually lies within sort of a different category of symbionts. These are facultative symbionts, meaning that they're not obligate from the host's perspective. Some insects have the bacteria, some do not, and those that are lacking tend to be just fine, but by and large. But let me add a caveat here. I just said facultative symbionts. Now, that is my personal shorthand, and I'm going to remind you now, because I probably won't do it again, that what I really mean when I say that are maternally inherited facultative bacterial endosymbionts, which is an incredible mouthful, which is why I don't say it every time I go through there. But let me break this down for you. So maternally inherited, these are symbionts that are passed from mother to offspring, usually through the cytoplasm of the egg, and are essentially a heritable trait. So just like maternally inherited, but something that's heritable, something that if the mother has it, the offspring is very, very likely to have it as well. I'm only going to be talking about bacteria. There are certainly other symbionts, fungi, microsporidians, that fall into the same category. I'm not going to be just speaking about them today. Endosymbionts. So I'm using this as something that's within the body of the insect, but not in the gut. So something that's either in the cytoplasm, in the cells themselves, or in the hemolymph of the insect. So I will not be talking about gut symbionts either, which, as I've said to a couple of you today, those gut symbionts are vastly too confusing for me. They have too many different things going on all at once. I like this particular type, and that will be what I'm talking about. So, as I've been talking about all of this, I haven't described the picture. And this is, again, the pea aphid. This is a different cut through of that U-shaped bacterium. And again, we have the obligate symbiont Buchnera fluorescing green. And for those of you that aren't red-green colorblind, you can see that this other symbiont here, Regiella, is fluorescing red. And Regiella falls into this facultative category that I've been describing. For a long time, we really didn't know what these facultative symbionts were doing. But it turns out they're doing some really fascinating things. And I took a bunch of these diagrams here from a fairly recent review by Kerry Oliver et al., an annual review. This is an excellent overview of facultative symbionts, particularly within aphids, which is one of our best known groups as far as these sorts of symbionts go. And oops, there we went. This symbiont Hamiltonella actually protects the pea aphid, in this case, against parasitism. So if a pea aphid that's lacking the bacteria is attacked by this wasp, Ophidius urbi, by and large, the wasp attack is successful, an egg is deposited, it develops, and a wasp is successfully produced, more than half the time in this particular case. On the other hand, when the aphid has the bacteria, same attack, egg is laid, egg or the embryo inside the insect, within the aphid host, dies as a consequence of the bacteria. And you know, while this effect that's shown here doesn't look tremendously dramatic, what you need to understand is this is sort of an average effect. And in fact, the protective ability of the symbiont depends on the particular strain of bacteria. And some of these bacteria are providing their hosts with virtually perfect protection against parasitism. So this is a really, really dramatic effect in some instances. Here's another symbiont, Serratia symbiotica, and another effect. In this case, the bacteria is protecting its aphid host against heat shock. We have an aphid that is lacking the symbiont that's given this blast of heat. Afterwards, in the absence of the symbiont, virtually all of them are sterile. They're not able to reproduce any further. But in contrast, one that has serratia gets the same treatment, and compared to an aphid that does not get the heat shock, the fecundity is reduced, but not nearly to the same degree as the uninfected aphids. So in this case, the bacteria is giving it some protection from an environmental condition. Regiella insecticola provides the aphid with protection against fungus. In this case, it is Pandora, not the music program, but a fungus that provides spores and is pretty deadly to aphids under some conditions. Again, the uninfected aphid, when challenged with Pandora spores, virtually all of them die. When the bacteria Regiella is present, still a lot of them die, but a much greater percentage of them survive. Interestingly, Regiella is also has some associations with host plants. This study by Tsuchida et al. Showed that when they cured Regiella out of the pea aphid, they found vastly reduced fecundity on this particular host plant, red clover, as compared to aphids that retained the Regiella. But I'll tell you right now that this is actually a considerably more complicated story than it might appear to be on the surface. Correlatively, there's a lot of association between Regiella and clover, but this sort of causality that they've shown was not easily replicated in some follow-up studies by other groups. So while there is some sort of host plant symbiont association within the system, the causality of it is very, very unclear at this point and particularly messy. Now, I don't know if any of you could see or were paying attention, but down here in the corner, I've been having my little credits, the citations going by for all of these studies. And if you had been looking, you would have noticed that essentially all of the studies I've just shown you were within the last 10 years. They've all been since 2003 or later. And the point I'm just trying to make here is that we're really just kind of at the tip of the iceberg in terms of understanding the sorts of things these facultative symbionts might be doing in their hosts. So if you take the best known of these sort of facultative symbionts, Wolbachia, which most people have heard of and is the most prevalent symbiont, and arguably the very most commonly studied insect, Drosophila melanogaster, it wasn't until 2008 that the story broke by two separate groups that some strains of this bacteria could be protecting their host against against viruses. Okay, so again, this well-characterized bacteria that we thought we knew an awful lot about is actually doing something else in addition to manipulating the reproduction of its host, which is usually what we think of in the context of Wolbachia. So we're just really starting to understand the sorts of phenotypes these facultative symbionts cause, and then there's this whole world of research beyond that that we need to understand more about. So we don't know very much about the geographic distribution of symbionts, how they're distributed within and among populations. We certainly don't know very much about how they're doing all these interesting things that they're doing. And there's going to be consequences to having or not having the symbiont. And so I'm particularly interested in these sort of ecological and evolutionary consequences. If there's a symbiont that protects against a parasitoid, that's going to affect the parasitoid in an ecological context. So these sorts of questions about how do symbionts influence the population dynamics of their hosts? Can they be, how are they influencing evolutionary processes such as adaptation and speciation? How do they affect these other organisms that they interact with, their competitors, their consumers, their consumees? All of these are these sorts of questions that I'm trying to get a hand, that would be interested to get a handle on. And let me give you one very concrete example here. This is sort of one of those ripped from the headlines things from last year, where we talked, Anna Himmler et al. Looked at a white fly, Bemisia tabicide, sweet potato white fly, one of the worst pests globally. And it has, in some instances, this symbiont rickettsia. What they found was that rickettsia increased juvenile survival of those white flies that were infected. It increased the juvenile development rate by 1 to 2 days. It doubled the number of offspring that the white fly was able to produce. And those offspring had a greater female sex bias than uninfected white flies. Given all that, it's not that surprising that the frequency of infection varied dramatically over the course of this particular study. So in the year 2000, they had these populations, oops, whoa, wrong one. preview, so close your eyes. So in 2000, they did this survey, they had these samples, and you can see that essentially everybody, all these populations they looked at were uninfected except for one individual down here in Yuma, Arizona, was rickettsia infected. Fast forward to 2003, and you can see that now essentially all the populations they looked at were mixed. And by 2006, virtually every white fly that they looked at was rickettsial infected. And this is not contagious transmission of a pathogen. This is just that those that have rickettsia are doing so much better than those that do not, that they came to dominate the population and sweep through the population within the span of only 6 years. And that trend stayed when they did a few more samples in 2008. So as you already got the preview, to me, my mind, this is really a case of sort of microevolution in action. We're seeing a change in frequency that is caused by the presence or absence of this bacteria. Those with the bacteria are just vastly outcompeting their uninfected compatriots. And it's not an isolated example. There's a couple of other recent very high profile studies in science, and both in science, that have shown a similar sort of phenomenon where a symbiont is really driving some of these ecological and evolutionary processes. What we don't know yet is how frequent of a pattern this is. We know it happens, but is this common? Is it something that is, you know, happening all the time and we've just never been looking for it? Or are these really exceptional cases? So what I'm going to argue is that we really need to understand a lot more about symbiont variation among and within populations if we're going to be able to, that's sort of the first step of what we need if we're going to then make those later steps of understanding these evolutionary processes. How common is it? Well, the first thing you need is variation to even be able to begin to see these. And right now I'm going to say we don't know nearly enough about this sort of variation to begin to say whether that's a common phenomenon or not. And I should emphasize that when I'm talking about this variation, I'm talking about sort of presence or absence or identity of these various facultative symbionts, but there's also variation within a symbiont. So you might say, well, I have Wolbachia. There's Wolbachia in there. Well, which Wolbachia is it? There's lots of different strains of Wolbachia. We're finding out that there can be many different strains of Wolbachia in the same individual. They might be able to recombine. There's bacterial phages that can transmit information across these various bacteria. So there's lots of ways to generate variation. Mostly, what I'm going to be talking about is sort of presence or absence or identity at the symbiont level, but I do want to make sure it's clear that there's also other levels of variation as well. So while my interest and my background, as you might have been able to tell from what Ian's introduction, is very ecological, I really want to get to the ecology and these interspecific interactions, I'm going to argue that before we can really get to these interesting bits down here, we need to know a little bit more upstream about what's going on. And this sort of basic question about geographic distribution is actually an important one. And so this first question I'm going to be dealing with today is a very simple, and while it's a question that might seem a little pedestrian, but is an important one. How much do facultative endosymbionts vary within and among populations? And I'm going to be addressing this particularly within aphid populations. Again, aphids are a group that we know quite a bit more about than a lot of other groups, but we still don't know that much. So let me justify that. This is again out of the same review paper by Carrie Oliver, in which they looked at symbiont distribution across aphids using single specimens per species. And what you can see is that using this sort of setup, that most, about half of the aphid species that they looked at had no facultative symbionts. The remaining half were divided fairly equally between, these are kind of the three big aphid symbionts, Serratia, Reggiella, and Hamiltonella, and then there's this little slice of the pie, which is all of the others that were within their survey set, none of which were any more than about 1% within that group. But this is a picture based on a single specimen per species, and you know, you pick one aphid and it happened to have Reggiella. Do they all have Reggiella? Do some of them have Reggiella? Do most of them? You don't get any sense of that from this. So what we did was we took a meta-analysis sort of approach and just got every possible aphid record that we could and looked at their symbiont distribution and who would screen for aphids in any way, shape, or form, any symbionts. And what we found is about 260 species that had ever been screened in any way, of which about 100 of them had a single individual screened, and that's all. And that's all we know about that aphid. A number of other aphids kind of fell in this middle ground, and then a few, very few, came up here at this rate where you could actually get a fairly good sense of the sort of variation. And I should bear in mind, even though some of these look like they might be pretty decent, this is any survey for any symbiont. So some of the surveys that went in here just looked for Wolbachia. Some of them just looked for Reggiella. Some of them were very comprehensive and might have found any symbiont that was there. Others only looked for a subset. So it's actually incredibly difficult to make any sort of comparisons. And my point here is just that the current literature that's available on aphids, one of our best understood systems, is still going to be insufficient to get any sort of picture of this sort of variation, with the exception of one species, and that's the pea aphid, which I've been mentioning multiple times. Pea aphid is the one species where, yes, we can actually start saying some things about its variation. First of all, pea aphid has a pretty exceptional number of different facultative symbionts. In addition to those big three I mentioned, there's Spiroplasma, there's Rickettsia, Rickettsiella, and the mysteriously named X-type. And so these surveys of pea aphid, there's a very nice study from France et al., appropriately in France, of which they found about a quarter of the aphids didn't have a symbiont at all. The remaining, about half of them were split with Serratia and Hamiltonella at the highest frequency, Spiroplasma and Reggiella a little bit less, and then a tiny bit of Rickettsia. And then a full quarter of them were multiply infected, where the same individual aphid had more than one bacterial symbiont within it, which is an important point. A different study by Tsuchida et al. Much earlier in Japan found a very, very different pattern. Here, about a third had no symbiont, a third had Serratia, most of the remaining third had Reggiella, with a couple of other symbionts represented in essentially no multiple infection. Okay, so you can see variation amongst populations, certainly within populations. And here is a third study in which they show variation amongst host plants. So this is Ferrari et al. They did a whole bunch of different host plants from a couple of locations. And I'm not going to spend much time on here, but I just want to make the point that the sort of profile of these different symbionts they looked for is very different amongst these different host plants. So aphids to get off of alfalfa had a lot of Hamiltonella, no Serratia. On pea was essentially the reverse. Clover fell in the middle with Reggiella, the one that was looked at for the clover as potentially allowing specialization on clover being the most common. Okay, so if our worldview of how symbionts are distributed on aphids is really just can only be driven by pea aphid, what we would conclude is that aphids have a tremendous diversity of symbionts. This varies within populations, it varies among populations. It differs amongst host plants, and multiple infections can be common, although they're not always so. Okay? But we don't know whether this is a special case. It's sort of the singular case where we have really a lot of information. So, enter my student. This is Christina. She is just about done with her master's degree. And the purpose of her master's was actually to do the same sort of work but in a different aphid. And despite the somewhat confusing name cowpea aphid rather than pea aphid, I'll emphasize this is a completely different subfamily of aphid. It's a different genus, Aphis crexivora. It does have some similarities with pea aphid. It is highly polyphagous, more so than pea aphid. It's 200 or more host plants over 19 different families. But it particularly likes legumes, as does pea aphid. It's a cosmopolitan aphid. It's found worldwide. But in contrast with pea aphid, it's almost exclusively clonal. It's parthenogenic almost everywhere that it's found. Christina's questions that she was attempting to deal with in her master's were first, this basic question I've been hitting on, how variable is symbiont infection frequency within and among populations? Is it influenced by geography? And is it influenced by host plant? So given those things, those inferences we were getting off of pea aphid, do they hold within the cowpea aphid, crexivora, which is, I'll usually just refer to it as crexivora. So first, we acquired a lot of aphids. We got, I think there's about a total of 44 populations that ended up in the final data set from all over the world. And we took a diagnostic approach to this. So we looked specifically, we had primers that will amplify specific bacterial symbionts and only that symbiont, and then we'd go through with each of our specimens and look specifically for each of these symbionts. We have the big three that I mentioned again, Reggiella, Hamiltonella, and Serratia. She also looked for Spiroplasma, Rickettsia, and Arsenophonus, all of which have also been reported from aphids. I should emphasize that this is not comprehensive. There could be other symbionts in the system as well that we did not look for. Had we started this project 2 or 3 years later, there probably would have been a much stronger pyrosequencing component to be able to pick up some of those possibilities, but given when we started and what we did, diagnostics is what we've got. That said, it ended up being a pretty good data set. The total in the final number is 739 aphids, and if you think about doing diagnostic PCRs, anybody does molecular work, she did at least 7 PCRs on each individual one of those aphids, sometimes more. And we did not have a multi-channel pipetter. So it was a lot of work. So I just want to give her full credit for this was a lot of work. And what I'm going to do first is just throw all of these aphids in one bin and just show you the sort of global picture of what we get from that. And it looks like this. You have the majority of aphids are uninfected. So again, more than half of them, we did not find any symbiont at all. But of the part that did have symbionts, the diversity was really high. We found every single symbiont we looked for. And I will again note, diagnostic PCR is a little funky. You'll get bands. Is it right? Is it wrong? We sequenced all of them to make not every individual, but at least one individual from each population that came up positive to be sure that it was really the symbiont we thought it was, and it was. So we have all 6 of the symbionts we looked for were there. And so this again suggests that there probably are other symbionts as well that we weren't looking for, and that there's probably more to learn in that respect. The most common symbiont was actually Arsenophonus, one that's not even present in the pea aphid. And we had almost no multiple infections. In fact, we had very few populations that had more than one symbiont in them. Usually what would happen is we'd look at a population, and within that population, some individuals had one symbiont, and some individuals had no symbionts, and that was essentially how things fell out. Now we start bringing that population level into it. I'm going to turn this question around a little bit. Instead of asking how many aphids were infected, I'm going to ask how many populations had at least some infected aphids. And there, the answer is most of them. So most populations we looked at, even though all of the aphids were infected, weren't infected, at least one individual was. And the reason this is important is because if you're thinking about sort of those dynamic processes that I've been talking about, that means that most populations are mixed, containing some individuals that have a symbiont and some individuals that don't. And I'll just point out also that only a fairly small fraction of these were populations that were uniformly infected with the same symbiont. Okay, so my point here is just that in most cases with this aphid, you have a population that is a mixed group of infected and uninfected individuals, which both has that sort of potential for evolutionary action, for selection to work on, that you might have differential selection across the symbiont types, and also sort of for dynamic interactions with other organisms. Most populations have variation. Okay, now going into that sort of geographic question, I'm just going to do a very coarse picture here and show that first in sort of the Australasian area, if you can kind of mentally recall what the overall picture looked like, it looks quite similar here for this region, except that the number of symbionts that were present was reduced. So instead of having all six, there was only three. And this was nine populations, about 140 individuals. Africa looks by and large the same, except maybe the fraction that were uninfected has gone up a little bit, and there were four symbionts represented instead of three, but the overall impression is pretty similar. Europe, on the other hand, had the full diversity of symbionts of that we found. And this is perhaps not surprising because it's thought that the center of distribution, the origin of the species of aphid, is actually European. So it might be not at all unexpected that that's where the greatest diversity is found. And then finally, the Americas, which do look a little bit different. We have much less Arsenophonus, much more Hamiltonella and Spiroplasma. So on this sort of extremely coarse level, it does look like there might be some level of geographic structuring, perhaps a difference between the sort of native range versus introduced ranges of this aphid. But let me add a caveat here. What you can't see from this picture is that these aphids we got, this is a really polyphagous aphid. So all of these populations of aphids we got, we took them from any plant. Anytime anybody could find this aphid, we took them. And as it turns out, we got aphids from lots of different host plants. There's only about four plants where we had sort of enough replication to begin to say anything about what their symbiont profiles look like. The first is Metacago sativa, the common alfalfa that's used as pasture everywhere. And what you'll see here is, even though, you know, the yellow Arsenophonus band was often dominant in most of those other groups, that's not very common here in alfalfa. Instead, what was most common was Hamiltonella. In Vicia faba, the faba bean or broad bean, things look different. Most of these individuals were uninfected, and those that were infected, most of what we saw was Arsenophonus. And cowpea. There were only four populations here. We were down to only 46 aphids. So again, the diversity, the sampling, the number of chances to have even picked up a symbiont is quite a bit lower. So it's maybe not surprising that the diversity looks lower. But what we did find was a different symbiont, Rickettsia. And then finally, locust, Robinia pseudoacacia. And that one looks different. Virtually all of the aphids that we got off of locust were infected with Arsenophonus. And any other symbiont was quite uncommon. Now, what's interesting here, so if you go back to that geographic picture, we didn't have much Arsenophonus here in the Americas, but that was because none of those 10 populations actually came off of locust. And so, likewise, the cowpea populations all came from Africa. So there's a tremendous confound between host plant and geography, which doesn't allow us to sort of separate out whether these effects that we're seeing are host plant effects or geographic effects. But fortunately, black locust, as anybody who might have looked around here might know, is that this is actually a really common plant in our local region. So the fact that that original survey didn't have any of them was something that we could rectify. It is, in fact, a North American plant. And so I went on a mission. This is northern Kentucky, the bluegrass region, and all of the blue pins were Aphis craxivora collections that I made off of locust. All of the yellow pins were made off of alfalfa. I had there's one green pin in the middle that happened to be my neighbor's and patient's plant, which was really convenient. But by and large, what I got was alfalfa and locust. And in the end, I had 14 alfalfa populations. We did diagnostic PCR on them, and looked at their symbionts, what we found was that essentially 90% of them, aphids for all the populations on average, had Hamiltonella, and not a single one of them had Arsenophonus. On locust, exactly the opposite. We never found Hamiltonella on any aphid, but the average proportion that were infected with Arsenophonus was about 90%. Just to really put the final nail in this coffin that there's a differential distribution, we did pyrosequencing as well. So this is a process where you take a general bacterial primer for 16S, amplify up this whole mix of different whatever was present within the aphids, and sequence all of them. So get tons of sequences out. It's like cloning, except on steroids. And so instead of having just a few, we ended up with about 30,000 reads from each of these two different plant species. We pooled a bunch of aphids from single aphids from different populations to do this. And again, what we find is that in alfalfa, not too surprisingly, the dominant symbiont, 80% of our reads came back Buchnera, the obligate symbiont, which is what you would expect. 19.2%, almost all of the remainder, was Hamiltonella. Out of those 30,000 reads, there was not one Arsenophonus, and everything else we got, which is mostly probably environmental contaminants, only acquired, it was about 0.2%. So it's really, really clear from this that these aphids have Buchnera, they have Hamiltonella, they really just don't have anything else. And again, the completely complementary picture from locust. Almost all Buchnera, no Hamiltonella at all, the remainder is Arsenophonus, nothing else. So this is great. We have this really, really incredibly clear pattern of symbiont association with host plants. And I'm going to come back to that in a minute, but let me just wrap up sort of this story of Christina's work. So to answer her questions, how variable is symbiont infection frequency within and among populations of Aphis craxivora? Well, it's really variable, but in a different sort of way than P. aphid. Whereas in P. aphid, you'd look in a population and see lots of different symbionts all together in various combinations. Here, you either get a symbiont or you don't. But within a population, that's where the variation lies. There's a mixture of singly infected and uninfected individuals. Is symbiont infection frequency influenced by geography? Maybe, but we'd need better sampling from a wider geographic range to really be able to tell on that point. But it is clear that symbiont infection frequency is related to host plant. Given that, we now have this opportunity to really get at some of these more interesting questions to me about what are the causes and consequences of this sort of host association pattern. You know, why do you get that? It might be differential ecology or selection. So perhaps those aphids that bear Hamiltonella are favored in alfalfa, and those that bear Arsenophonus are favored on locust for various ecological reasons. Or maybe they're just historical relics. Maybe the aphid that's got to specialize on alfalfa happened to have Hamiltonella, and the aphid that specialized on locust happened to have Arsenophonus, and they're really two separate biotypes with differential infection. Or maybe the symbiont is a consequence of the host plant. You know, these are different host plants, there's different environments, there's different other insects in the environment. Some of these insects pick up symbionts from horizontal transfer, at least at some rate over evolutionary time. And so populations of this aphid that are on different host plants have different opportunities to get different symbionts. And in fact, there's some suggestion that horizontal transmission of some symbionts can occur through the plant. There's a nice study earlier this year that showed that in Bemisia, Rickettsia, the symbiont that did that sweep, actually in some cases can enter the plant and be transmitted through the plant to another whitefly. Given that possibility, it's possible that one or both of these host plants might be able, the same thing might be able to happen. And if it's going to happen anywhere, we suspect it's Arsenophonus. Arsenophonus, by and large, is a more competent bacteria than Hamiltonella is. Hamiltonella is almost exclusively restricted to aphids. Arsenophonus is in a lot of other things, and in some cases is, in fact, a plant pathogen. So it suggests that the insect host versus plant host may be a little bit more labile within that aphid. We're looking into it. We haven't gotten any results on that yet. Or finally, host plant might be a consequence of symbionts. So that idea that a symbiont might facilitate specialization with on a particular host plant may be the case, that one or both of these symbionts allows that particular strain of aphid to use that host plant, whereas the one that doesn't have the symbiont can't do so. Unfortunately, I don't have any answers on this part of the these interesting questions yet, but this is sort of the ongoing research of one of my coming graduate students, Steve Wagner. Ideally, what we want to have here is a situation in which we take aphids from both plants of origin, alfalfa and locust, and that are naturally infected with Hamiltonella arcifonis, clear out their infections using antibiotics, which can be done, particularly because Buchnera is as an obligate symbiont, is pretty, it's reduced. It's got a very reduced genome, so it doesn't have a lot of the same targets that other bacteria do. So you can pick antibiotics that, for example, target a cell wall. Those will work against the facultative symbionts. They won't work against the obligate. So you can clear out facultative symbionts without influencing this necessary obligate symbiont. Once you get those lines, then you can test them across the different host plants, both alfalfa and locust, and then also fava, which seems to be a pretty universally acceptable host plant for both of these aphid types. In fact, that's how we keep them in colony in our lab. Unfortunately, while we have clearly have both of the original infected lines, and we've developed Ham minus alfalfa origin aphid, we don't yet have the Arce minus locust line. So I won't be able to show you this sort of full set of experimental crosses because we don't have all the aphids yet. And so Steve this summer has been doing various subsets to try and get a handle on what's going on without being able to do the whole shazam. He did a greenhouse study where he just compared the Ham plus and Ham minus alfalfa origin aphids across all plants. And I will tell you now that this was the first round of an experiment. There were some issues. And so he's redoing that experiment as we speak. And we'll have that answer shortly about whether that symbiont differentially affects its ability to deal with these three different host plants. Very soon, does not have it yet. To just get a sense of whether these locust origin aphids, how they do on the different host plants, we had an undergraduate do a very small scale study across the different plants. And then Steve has also just checked the three different aphid types all on a common host plant on locust to see how they do. And what we can say so far is that for those Arce plus aphids that originated from locust, they do great on locust. They do really badly on alfalfa. The population sort of stumbled along for the week or so of this experiment, but they didn't really grow. And I can tell you from longer experience, they really don't do well. It's not really easy to maintain a population of locust origin aphids on alfalfa. When we just looked on locust here, again, you can see that the locust origin aphids did really well on locust, and the Hamiltonella aphids, alfalfa origin aphids, whether or not they had Hamiltonella, did badly here and here. And then I can also tell you that when we try to do, this covers it. We've got locust origin aphids on locust do well, do poorly on alfalfa. Alfalfa origin aphids do poorly on locust. So that's really just the take home that I'm trying to get across here. So each aphid performs poorly on the alternate host, which leads us sort of to this initial level of conclusion that we're probably dealing with separate aphid origins. Separate aphid lineages that have somewhat specialized on their different host plants. This is corroborated, to a small degree, by some of CO1 data that we've collected. Now, we did this primarily to reassure ourselves that these little black aphids that people sent us from all over the world were really Aphis craxivora. I mean, here, there's not that many other things that might be confused with them, but in different regions, such as Europe, there's a lot of other little black aphids as well. And so to convince ourselves that, yes, we're really, even though this looks right, let's make sure it's the right species, we did this barcoding to be able to blast them and make sure that that it matched up with what it was supposed to be. And in fact, we did end up discarding one population because it was a sister species instead of what it was supposed to be. But we got some corollary information from it as well. What we found was that this 460 base pair segment had 10 different haplotypes across our different aphids. one of which was quite a bit divergent than the rest, but the rest of them were all quite similar. They were only, by and large, differ from each other by only two bases. Okay, so out of those 460, any pair of them, 458 were the same, two were different. And most of the aphids that we looked at fell out into two haplotypes, which I'm calling 1A and 2. And these were distributed non-randomly across our host plants. Most of the alfalfas were 1A. All of the locusts were haplotype 2. So this is actually really convenient for us because now we actually have a polymorphism we can look at if we're willing to sequence them and say, when we're working with them, that yes, this is probably sort of this group of aphids versus that group of aphids. So we can use that as a confirmation in various experiments that we do. It also falls out for symbionts. Most of the Hamiltonella aphids that we had in that group were haplotype 1A, and most of the Arsenophonus aphids were haplotype 2. So what we can say is that Hamiltonella and Arsenophonus are associated with separate aphid lineages that are associated with different host plants. But the causation on this is still completely unclear. We don't know why that would be and sort of which is the cart and which is the horse. But because Craxivora that's associated with different plants has different symbionts, this is going to have ecological consequences regardless of why it's that way. The fact of the matter is there is this pattern and these symbionts do different things. Hamiltonella, as I've already intimated, is a well-characterized symbiont that protects aphids from parasitism. And this was done in P. aphid, but it's also, we have collaborators that are working on the same pattern within Aphis craxivora, and it does the same thing. And interestingly, it doesn't work equally well against all parasitoids. So some parasitoids are protected, or it's protected against some parasitoids, but not others. It's also clear that Hamiltonella has some fitness costs. When you mix a group of Hamiltonella-bearing and non-Hamiltonella-bearing aphids within a jar, eventually the non-Hamiltonella aphids are going to win. There's a cost to bearing Hamiltonella. So that means there's a trade-off. There's going to be a trade-off between aphids that are protected from parasitism and those that grow better, which means that there's going to be lots of dynamic interactions going on with the symbiont. It's going to influence host-parasitoid interactions. It's going to be influencing population dynamics. And because of these differential parasitoid effects, there might be even affecting competition amongst different parasitoids in a field environment. Arsenophonus, we have no idea what it does. And I'm going to just take a side detour here into yet another student's work, and I'm going to stray away from Craxivora for just a moment, because my student Jason's project has been to investigate the function of Arsenophonus in a different yet very well-known aphid, Aphis glycines, the soybean aphid, which in addition to being a major invasive soy pest here in the U.S., virtually all soybean aphids are infected with Arsenophonus. And so his project was to figure out why. He actually has cured out Arsenophonus from soybean aphid. He's done it from a number of different lines now. All the research I'm going to show you in the next few slides was just two different isolines. He used ampicillin. And first, let me just point out the scale of anybody who's not worked with soybean aphid. These are about an order of magnitude smaller than P. aphid. So it's not an inconsiderable task to be able to micro-inject them. And this isn't the clearest picture in the world, but you can see, you know, this aphid is adhered with vacuum to a 1 mil micropipette tip, and this extruded needle is eventually, you know, the scale is about like this coming into the aphid. So a lot of them don't survive the process, and it's apparently really unpleasant to watch as aphids explode. But it's, some of them do survive, and he has functionally been able to do this. And so it's pretty impressive, actually, to have as many lines as he does. And the question he started out with is, of course, well, okay, we know a lot of these aphids are defensive, and let's just go ahead and look for parasitism. Let's make sure Arsenophonus isn't essentially just another bacteria that's doing exactly the same thing as Hamiltonella. His first parasitoid he worked with is Bynodoxis communis, which was is a released biocontrol agent here in the U.S. against soybean aphid. It turns out it's not a very good one, but it's the only one that we have a permit for, so that's one that we could use. And he did three different assays with these. He used whole plant assays where he chucked some aphids on a plant, put the parasitoid on for a day, came back and counted mummies 10 days later. He did a separate one where he had a more controlled number of aphids, so he was able to actually sort of keep track of the individual aphids, gave them on a leaf disc that's embedded in auger to the wasp, and then was able to keep track of things a little more tightly. And then finally, he actually watched the parasitize individual aphids and then take those aphids and move them over. So this, you know, in this case, all the aphids that he saw getting parasitized, he knows that they, you know, they were attacked. Three different assays, two different lines, so there's six experiments that are kind of compiled here, and what you can see, there's absolutely no difference. They were all parasitized at a pretty good rate, whether or not Arsenophonus was present. So the blue lines have Arsenophonus, the cream ones do not. We did not find any evidence that Arsenophonus protected against parasitism. So he tried again. This time he used, we knew that from the Hamiltonella work that it might matter what the parasitoid identity is. Here he picked Aphelinus certus. This is a more generalized aphid. It's in a different family. It's an aphelinid rather than a braconid. Same three assays, functionally the same result. He never did see any difference in parasitism between the infected and uninfected aphids. Now, either because he's a glutton for punishment or because I'm a really mean advisor, we tried one more time. And this time we used Aphidius colemanni, which is another braconid. It's very generalized as opposed to the specialist Bynodoxus. And this is a parasitoid that we know is affected by Hamiltonella, at least in some cases, for example, in the aphid Aphis fabi. Did it again, same result. No difference in parasitism. So it's really disappointing to get a lot of negative results, but you know, sometimes the answer is negative. Sometimes it's just not doing the thing that you're looking for. So does Arsenophonus protect soybean aphid from parasitism? Doesn't look like it. At least with the three parasitoids that we looked at least with the strains of Arsenophonus and aphid genotypes that we looked at, no. The answer seems to be no. And it should be borne in mind, you know, this is an invasive aphid here. There's not a lot of genotypic diversity anyway, so it's not like the fact that there were only two genotypes behind this. It's probably pretty representative of what's actually out there in the field anyway. Now, despite being somewhat disappointing as a first experiment for a PhD student, it's actually good news, at least from a biological control perspective, because that means you don't need to be worrying about Arsenophonus. Does your lab colony have Arsenophonus when you're doing trials of the back parasitoids that you're about to release? Do you have to worry about whether Arsenophonus is there or not? Apparently not. And so Jason has moved on to many other questions looking at what Arsenophonus really is doing, because again, almost all aphids have it. So our working hypothesis is doing something, but we're still trying to figure out what, and right now he's sort of off onto doing various interactions with host plants to see whether that might be an influence. So coming back here to our main story about Craxivora, what is Arsenophonus doing? Well, it's probably not parasitism protection. And even though, you know, that other result, and I'm not basing that purely on what we just saw in soybean aphid, Christina, bless her heart, in addition to all those other PCRs she did on the local survey, she also did a PCR for each of them for Hymenopteran DNA. So in addition to all these other studies, we had a sense of what the parasitism pressure was like on our various populations. And in fact, these Hamiltonella-bearing alfalfa aphids had a lower rate of parasitism than the Arsenophonus-bearing locust populations. And in fact, one of these populations, there was 90% parasitism. And in fact, we tried to culture that group and we're having a very difficult time because everybody was emerging as parasitoids. So we really don't feel like Arsenophonus is providing parasitism protection. And I will not be able to tell you what Arsenophonus does, but given that it's something different than Hamiltonella, we have a really interesting system in which to contrast two different host plants, two different symbionts, two different phenotypes, and I'll just advise you to stay tuned for future developments on it. And with that, I'm sorry I talked really fast. I'm happy to take any questions. And this is my acknowledgments, my many lab mates, the aphid wranglers who sent us aphids from all over the place, and the Kentucky Extension agents and alfalfa growers who let me sample their fields, get a special thanks. So thank you.